What I'm going to do today, I'm going to tell you a story. And the story is what we have been doing in order to make actually Bristol a place for digital urban transformation. And what we are doing here is actually gathering quite a lot of following all around the world, and is evolving all the time to very interesting directions. So I'm going to talk about past, and I'm going to talk about plans for the future. So it was about 4 or 5 years ago when I arrived here at Bristol, and it's not about me arriving, but at that point, we actually felt that we had a mission, or shall I say we had a dream. And the dream was to make actually Bristol a national, international leader in urban innovation. And when I'm talking about innovation, although I'm mostly going to talk about digital, it's really both digital and social, but I don't feel actually that it's in my field to talk about social innovation. We have a lot of colleagues that are doing this stuff very well. The headline is that we wanted actually to make Bristol the UK's smartest, but also the more livable city. And we must be doing something right, because I don't know if you noticed, actually Bristol was named a couple of years now in Sunday Times as the best place to live in the UK. And actually a few weeks ago, Bristol won the Smartest City Award in an event that actually is sponsored by Huawei. It is the first time that Bristol overtook London in terms of being smart. So why we thought that we are able to take this challenge, and the reason was of a number of things that collectively, not each one individually, we think are unique for Bristol. The first one is that the fact that we had and we are having a lot of city leadership. Our city has always, our city council and now our West of England combined authority, which represent the region, has always been very ambitious in terms of digital vision. The second one, of course, we are having a world-class university and University of Bristol, and it's not only engineering that you are here, it's our social science colleagues, they are our lawyers, they are our business colleagues, finance, our finance department, so we are all here together to provide all the different parts, from technology to analyzing social effects of digital to actually getting into the business models. Also, we have a strong high-tech industry cluster here, and I know that a lot of you are coming from the region, and actually Bristol and the region has been a lot of times named as the second biggest digital cluster in the UK after London, so we are doing a lot of high-tech stuff. We have local partnerships that we are working very closely together. Watershed, representing our creative community, NGSED, has been named several times as the top high-tech incubator in the world, not only in the country. And then community initiatives like the Northwest Media Center, for instance, that they are very ambitious in terms on how to educate and give digital skills to their own community. So we are working all together. We have large national and international collaborations. We are working with big cities around the world, with Barcelona and Berlin, for instance, that I'm personally working, with Guangzhou in China, with Chicago in US, with Rio in Brazil. So we are working within an ecosystem of big mega cities sometimes in a very ambitious but very collaborative environment. We also had a little bit of funding from DCMS. We had about 4.5 million back in 2013, which helped an awful lot. And we have a group of extremely committed individuals. So just everything came together at one time and we said, we have to do something about it. And I'm going to talk about one initiative, concentrating on the digital, because there are other things that happen around environmental, around social initiatives and so on. So the initiative that I have been involved is called Bristol is Open. And this is a project. So the city council and the university got together and they said, we have actually to do something to drive urban innovation in the city, in the region, nationally, internationally. At that time, I mentioned we had a little bit of funding, which was a good thing, because we didn't go actually to do a full smart city, because we didn't have the funds to do it, but we used this initial seed funding actually to do something absolutely unique, to create a testbed, to create a platform where we can actually experience digital innovation, transfer it this afterwards for the bigger environments. When actually we start Bristol is Open as a testbed, we were the first city testbed initiatives. Now they are coming and they're created all around the world. So really that was one part, opening up a testbed for digital innovation, for smart city innovation at that time is something else that I believe that we given to the world as a tool actually for creating value out of city environments. I'll go a little bit on what this testbed looks like. So the first one, if you are looking at a city, is not a single one or two technologies environment. It's really a very heterogeneous. So if you want to speak about a heterogeneous network, then a city is the best example that you can find. So the first one, the first principle of our platform is embrace this technology diversity. Put there all the elements that actually they represent an environment in a smart in a digital city. So fiber, packet networks, computing, storage, cloud, wireless, IoT, cameras, all the digital elements that they are used in a full chain of delivering actually smart services. The second one, we wanted to eliminate actually any technology, any lock-in technologies. We didn't want to become the Cisco city, the Microsoft city, the IBM city. We didn't want actually to work with a single vendor, but we wanted to work with everybody. So we wanted actually, the focus was not to have the big vendors come and play here, although we have them and we enjoy it. We wanted actually to open this environment specifically for the SMEs, the small companies, that they are actually producing early product prototypes, both hardware and software, and they wanted to have an environment which is open enough to plug them in, to actually try them, demonstrate them, and therefore try to accelerate the innovation cycle. But not only vendor agnostic, but also technology agnostic. Look what's happening. When we start Bristol is open, we were actually doing the transfer or transition between 3G and 4G in terms of mobile networks. Now we are moving very fast to 5G. My colleagues that are doing wireless, for instance, they're talking about beyond 5G. We would like actually a platform that's going to be relevant now and very long in the future. We would like to be able actually to try multiple applications. So we are looking at a platform to really be able to tackle real city problems like transport, congestion, the environment, media, content, of course, to do technology trials. I mean, we're in an engineering department. Many of us, we're interested deeply about technology and how to trial it, how to demonstrate it, and of course, involve the end users. So what are our end users? Our end users are as diverse as our technology. We work with industry as end users, with our SMEs, with the local government, their stakeholders in this project, researchers across the university, and most importantly, our community and citizens. So this is how we looked. Those are the principles, the fundamentals of designing Bristol is Open. And I'll show you very quickly, two slides only, to show you the deployment that we have gone through. So here is the map of city of Bristol is Open as it is at the moment. We invested quite a lot on fiber. We have a very rich metro network, fiber metro network that we have installed in the center of the city. I'm a great believer that you have to invest first on fiber before you do anything else. You don't want to bottleneck in the very heart of your network. We invested quite a lot on wireless. So at the moment we have a flavor of multiple wireless technologies from Wi-Fi to 4G and then some other more exotic wireless technologies that we put early on, even before the whole trend on 5G. So millimeter wave that is provided by actually a Bristol startup company called Blue Wireless, and then some new actually frequency bands like or spectrum bands like 60 gigahertz backhaul. So that is what existing at the moment within the infrastructure. Of course, you cannot have a smart city without having IoT. So we installed an IoT RF mesh network that doesn't actually cover only the center of the city, but really reaches most of the city of Bristol. And of course, we have very big installation, very big deployment of computing infrastructures. The network is reaching and is connecting with high-performance computing here at the university. We are providing our own cloud service, so we have commodity cloud, and increasingly also we're installing mobile-edge computing. So all the flavors of different computational capabilities or facilities that you would need to do from scientific experimentation down, for instance, to mobile-edge computing is existing and is developing further right now at Bristol is Open. Here it gives you an idea on the kind of installation that we went through, just to mention Wi-Fi again, 60 gigahertz. This is our millimeter wave blue wireless. 4G networking, our IoT network, but we also had the opportunity, and my colleague Mark Pitts is there, that has done some fundamental pioneering work, for instance, on bringing massive MIMO capability for experimentation in the city, so research prototypes from the labs going out in the city for actually do groundbreaking work that has a lot of research and scientific value. And here, Mark worked with National Instruments to make this happen. So we are actually in a position where we can take prototypes in our labs, put them into the city, and experiment with these technologies at very early stages. We are also connecting with the new city operations center. Now this is of big, again, another innovation coming from Bristol. So this is a Bristol City Council facility. It's not Bristol is open. It's a single space where actually the council start bringing data from different sectors and actually consolidating data. And Bristol is open has a connection into this, which actually gives us the opportunity now to connect the ICT infrastructure with the data infrastructure and start really designing smart services, do really smart demonstrations across the city. To give you an idea, some of the data that they are actually either being hosted already or are going to be hosted in this operation center is traffic control, CCTV monitoring, for instance, a surveillance camera, some data from telecare, transport operators, experimental data as well. I mean, we would like actually to host the data from research platforms like Bristol is open in the same operation center. Now, what I talked about up to now, so I talked about pieces of kit, you know, switches, fiber, wireless, sensors, data, those things. They don't actually give you a smart infrastructure. You have to do some extra things to make your infrastructure smart. And actually, in Bristol is open, we didn't say we are making it smart. We said we make it programmable. And I'm going to say to show you what we mean from that. So we had two big pieces of innovation. The first one, we introduced a service, which we call City Experimentation as a Service. Let's see what it means. Let's say that we want actually to demonstrate two different applications. One, a public safety application, really something that Bristol City Council probably is going to be very interested to study, to demonstrate, to actually look for solutions, and the other, a new radio technology from one of our researchers. And we would like actually to demonstrate this from the same infrastructure. So this is the city infrastructure. Everything is sitting there, you know, at different places. Then when you are looking at public safety, the application would say, okay, I need cameras. I need probably some mobile surveillance unit. I need some computer storage so I can store my data and I can process the data. And of course, I need some connectivity infrastructure. Now, if you are looking at the new radio technology would like to be placed within the network, probably being interfaced with some other wireless or other connectivity technologies, and probably it's going to need some cloud service just to make an end-to-end environment for the new radio. So what we do, we created what we call an infrastructure slicing engine, and you can go out there and see actually a demonstration of how we do infrastructure slicing. And what this infrastructure slicing engine does, it creates what we call a city slice from the public safety. You see here what the public safety needs. It's actually the camera, the mobile surveillance, some connectivity, some compute. This actually infrastructure is allocated, so public safety demonstration actually or trial has its own city environment, and then we are actually creating another environment for the new radio technology, and of course we keep those secure. And because we are using our experts that actually we hear in the panel previously. So what is happening, and this is not only two slices, we can create hundreds of these slices of the city. So applications go, they say what they need in terms of the infrastructure, they get their own city slice to work on this. That is what we call programmability. That's why we say that our city is programmable, because actually we allow the application to program the city itself. It customizes the environment of experimentation. So this is the first. There is a demo outside. The second one is we package all this, all the control and management of the city infrastructure into a single platform, which we call the city operating system. Now, when you are thinking about the city OS, think it like Android for smart cities. So if you remember, and most of us remember, years ago, before we had Android, we were buying, for instance, the Nokia phone or a Samsung phone. I don't remember if Samsung was around before Android, but let's say, for reasons of illustration, you buy your Nokia phone, you buy the phone, you buy the operating system. On top of that, you only run the applications that actually that your phone platform provider allows you to run. Which means that actually you are locked to the vendor, you are locked to the hardware. Now, Android came, and what happened with Android? We all actually have the same operating system, which is Android, and we all run the same apps. We can download the same apps, and the way it's mentioned, the issues of vulnerability that goes around that. But the thing is, we can create our own apps as well. And you have an environment where what kind of phone actually you have, it doesn't matter. And then the thing is that the same we are doing here, we have this CityOS, so it doesn't matter actually commoditize the city, the technology, the communication technology, the network technology that you are deploying within the city. What does this mean? Is that like, for instance, mobile phone vendors, now all these vendors there, I'm sorry, Michael, that's not good for equipment vendors, but the thing is, equipment vendors do not like that, but they have to do something a little bit more to add value to what they are offering in terms of equipment. Like the mobile phones, for instance, you don't go to buy a phone, you go to buy a camera, you go to buy three cameras, four cameras, you know, ultra high definition camera in your phone. You buy your phone not because it's a phone, you buy the phone for the extra features that it's providing. That's what we expect to happen. So you take the value out of here, you bring the value out at the top, at the application, because now what we can do, we can actually create applications for the smart city, and we can create, share, and trade applications the same way, again, that you can do that in a smart mobile phone environment. If you go out there, there is a demonstration of the CityOS. You are going to see it with the name NetOS rather than the CityOS, because what we are doing here is obviously not only for cities. It could be for any kind of network or any kind of enterprise environment. We don't do this project only for technology purposes. Technology actually deployment and trials is not a self-fulfilling purpose. We're doing for these kind of things, for smart innovations. And there are a lot of things that are happening. Again, there is quite a lot of demonstrations out there, but I'm just going to speak about a few of them that are very close to my heart. The one is city data visualization. I don't know if you know, and if you know Bristol, in the Millennium Square, we have a planetarium. And we actually converted this planetarium to a very high resolution 3D visualization facility. And it's connected with Bristol is Open. It's connected with all the sensors connected with Bristol is Open. Which means that what we can do, we can real time collect and visualize data from the city in 3D. What does this mean? We have done some spectacular demonstrations of this. That means that, for instance, take an example that you are doing a demo, you are looking at pollution levels in the city, let's say in the Park Street. You collect the data real time, you visualize them in 3D. It's shocking actually to see how polluted the city is sometimes, but what you do at the same time, you do interventions, and you see how actually these interventions, for instance, closing the street is the perfect thing. No cars, pollution levels, they drop down immediately. The other thing is augmented reality. We have a new lab here at Bristol, and it's a collaboration between University of West of England, Bristol University, our creative communities. Quite a lot of apps, quite a lot of use cases are coming around augmented virtual reality, mixed reality. Autonomous transport, somebody mentioned even before in the panel, we're having three autonomous transport, autonomous car projects that actually we are running here at Bristol. And another thing, we are working now not only in the city but across the region to put forward a case for smart tourism. So imagine this case that you go to SS Great Britain, you are having a hologram of Brunel sitting with you and telling you, actually explaining, you know, there and there, the engineering and the financial challenges of actually making the whole thing happen. So we are doing a lot of things like this. It involves more than the university, the city council community. Actually involves a lot of small companies, specifically larger companies around the region. But what we've seen, for instance, take those two examples here.
our current network, although is really state of the art, it can never give you the kind of reaction times, the kind of latency to actually support autonomous transport. You need really very fast reaction times there. And it's critical, because if you see somebody cross the road, you have to stop the car. And actually, you cannot tolerate faults or delays there. The second one, if you are looking, for instance, on this transfer of holograms, and Huawei has done quite a lot of this, of these demos, you need ultra-high bandwidth. At the moment, from our wireless access devices, we cannot actually deliver this kind of bandwidth to the user. So you all heard possibly about the fifth generation mobile technology, or 5G. It's offering to solve a lot of problems, not only for end-user communication, but actually transforming the whole industry. So they're offering very, very low reaction times, less than 1 millisecond, perfect for autonomous transport. They are offering actually 100 times at least more bandwidth to the end user devices, even more. And actually, if you are looking at IoT and machines, standards already talking about 1 million devices per square kilometer, and I'm sure very soon we are going to be talking more than that. So what happened? The UK government back in the last statement announced 740 million of capital funding for what is being called as Local Full Fiber Networks Program, and Bristol is part of it already, and also 5G testbed and trials. I mean, what the UK government realized that introducing, understanding 5G early on in trial environments, in testbed environments, like for instance Bristol is open, is critical for driving innovation, not only in the mobile phone sector, but in the whole industry, in all sorts, in all group of industry sectors. So the first part of this testbed and trials is actually to install what they are called test networks across the country. Start very early to build the environments to start trialing different applications. And we are actually one of the places that we are developing one of the first testbeds, 5G, what is called end-to-end 5G testbeds for the UK. This program is 16 million of capital funding. And the most important, we have to demonstrate by the end of March of 2018. So very short time, but here we are going for leadership. We want in the UK to be the first that we are going to be the end-to-end. Not single vendor trials, but end-to-end trials. And the flavor here at Bristol, we are going to be the first environment that actually we are going to have an urban, a city installation of 5G, the first in the world. And we're really very excited about this, what we are doing, and I'm not going into the technical details. We are doing the 5G test, but not in our labs, but in the Millennium Square down at Bristol. And what we are planning to do, we are not going to keep the experiments for ourselves. We are going to open them for the public, for the Bristol citizens, for our visitors. So this is going to happen the 17th and 18th of March. I invite you all to be there. I mean, it's very important. We are expecting about 5,000 people in the square. We are looking at safety issues about this. But what we are going to have, so there are going to be installations inside the museum, installations outside in the square. There are a number of demonstrations. WaterSet is actually preparing the content of the demonstrator, but we are going to have demos that they are going to test ultra-high latency, so different mobility cases, cases where we are going to have interactions of human with robots, because you cannot fake that. You can fake robot to robot, as you know. You cannot fake human to robot. We are going to have some amazing mixed reality AR, VR showcases, huge, immersive, stunning immersive experiences within the dome. And then inside the museum, actually, we are going to look at the future of 5G, the future of communications. We are going to have a demonstration of Li-Fi. Not 5G, but how you can get actually very high speed connectivity out of your LEDs. So we're going to show that what we're creating here, again, is actually generation, technology generation agnostic, is going to go to 5G and beyond. So the whole idea is to move actually and expand then this to the whole Bristol is open infrastructure beyond Bristol is open into the region and start working and demonstrating different sectors, not only smart cities, but also smart regions. Not only autonomous cars, but all creating here, hopefully, a whole transport hub for testing. Looking at issues of health and social care, and you're going to see our Sphere project, for instance, outside. Manufacturing is important. We have a huge robotic activity here at Bristol. Again, there are demos outside. 5G is going to be for instance, very important when we are looking at robotic applications. So we are opening up with 5G, our testbed, our city testbed, to all sorts of different sectors and experiences. Just an acknowledgement to the partners that they're working with us. Our main vendor is Nokia. We are working with BT. We are working with a number of local partners and local SMEs to deliver this. And thank you. And some acknowledgement on the some of the original people that actually brought the vision forward for Bristol Soap. Thank you.